Hello and welcome to Tropical Tuesday, and in this edition we will be talking about the marriage ceremony of Lhops. So to talk more on this, I have with me Madam Ngong Chuden, who presented a research paper on a unique marriage ceremony of Lhops, a small community in Samtse Dzongkhag, during the 8th colloquium on the tangible and intangible culture recently in Paro. So Madam Ngong Chuden, a very warm welcome to our show, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Ma'am, if you could introduce yourself to our listeners first.
Before I begin with my topic, I first of all would like to introduce myself. My name is Ngawong Chodin. I work with the National Land Commission as a land registrar. Mm-hmm. Before, I used to work with the National Library and Archives. Now I'm being transferred to National Land Commission upon being selected through the Bhutan Civil Service examinations. So when I was working with the National Library, I had an opportunity to work with my senior colleagues in the field, and I have also collected some of the data related to tangible and intangible culture of Bhutan. And I also got a few tips in how to go about in writing research articles, and to write an article, there should be someone behind you who should encourage and support you in writing. There are my friends who always support and encourage me to keep writing. Mm-hmm. So this is how I drag myself into writing. Mm-hmm. And for today's colloquium, mm-hmm, for National Museum, I have contributed an article on the topic, The Marriage Custom of Lhops and Its Change.
Yes, ma'am. First of all, what interested you to do a research or study on this unique culture of marriage?
The main interest of doing this research is that every one of us out here knows that we are living in the age of globalization. Mm-hmm. And in the age of globalization, giving up one's rich culture and embracing modern culture could bring social fissure in the future. Mm-hmm. And also at present, if we are ignorant of the values of one's culture and tradition, then after a few years, not too far from now, the cultural diversity and the regional identity of the country may diminish with, mm-hmm, the passage of time, and Lhops are no exceptions. Because of, mm-hmm, that reason, I am inspired to write an article on this very topic.
Mm-hmm. So, ma'am, how is marriages of Lhops different from our usual Bhutanese marriages?
So, instead of talking the difference, mm-hmm, I will talk about the uniqueness of their, yes, marriage culture. The unique thing that I see in Lhop marriage culture is that people of Lhop community has a strong belief that marriage has to be occurred, mm-hmm, within their own community people. And the community also has a rigid culture of marrying their own people. Mm-hmm. The culture of Lhop marrying only Lhop peoples has been passed down through the generations. And even to this day, marrying within Lhop is considered as an integral part of the community lives. Mm-hmm. And besides, Lhop people believe that when their people are married to their own people, then this practice helps continue their community clan. Mm-hmm. But if community people are married to outsiders, which means the people who are not belongs to the Lhop community, then it is believed to distort their family, clan, and community harmony. And for this reason, especially the elderly Lhops people, they never encourage their daughter to marry outsiders.
Mm-hmm. Ma'am, if you could also narrate us on how the marriage ceremony is being conducted in their community.
Okay.
Marriage rituals.
So, for that, I will talk about the procedure that are involved in marriage ceremony in Lhop community. First procedure that, as I mentioned earlier, mm-hmm, the procedure that are involved in Lhop marriage culture is that first the boy and girl will show their affairs through their actions, mm-hmm, where they are often found to be working together, walking together, mm-hmm, and they are also found to be eating together. Mm-hmm. And these actions are the indications of their early affairs, and, mm-hmm, also in that cases, parents will not interfere in that matter. Mm-hmm. And female members in the Lhop communities are considered as the backbone or the strength of the family, because it is only through female that helps continue the family clan. And, mm-hmm, for that reason, people never encourage the marriage of female Lhops with outsiders. And, mm-hmm, also female members must occupy their ancestral house, and they have to continue with their family clan. Mm-hmm. They cannot go and become somebody else's daughter-in-law.
Yes. So, ma'am, do you have anything to say on this marriage ceremony in particular, ma'am?
Marriage ceremony is very unique in their community. For instance, for the purpose of a marriage ceremony, to proceed with the marriage ceremony, mm-hmm, firstly, they have to begin the ceremony with the purification, mm-hmm, ceremony. And the purification ceremony is being started early in the morning by the groom. And it is during this purification ceremony that a groom has to get one live chicken. Mm-hmm. And he will clutch its neck and slam its head against the threshold for 3 times. Mm-hmm. And then he will slit its neck and dispense its hot blood into the bamboo container. Mm-hmm. And inside the bamboo container, the groom will also pour the sieved millet liquor, mm-hmm. the locally termed as bangchang. Mm-hmm. He will pour that liquor into that bamboo container, and by using the small bamboo stick, the blood and that sieved millet liquor thoroughly get mixed. After thorough mixture of that blood and the sieved millet liquor, then by using the small bamboo stick, the groom draws a red cross sign in front of the every threshold as a mark of cleansing impurities or defilement for the community members. So this purification ceremony is considered to be very necessary, mm-hmm. because if people fail to carry out the purification ceremony, then it is believed that this will result in lots of misfortunes to the mm-hmm. community and the family members, both in terms of health and harvest. So if community people are to have a bountiful harvest and good health, then purification ceremony is necessary. So after having purification ceremony only, then they can proceed for marriage ceremony. And the marriage ceremony is often held in the simple way. Mm-hmm. They do not organize any meal, but instead of meal, they will offer excessive bangchang mm-hmm. or the sieved millet liquor to the community people. And the marriage ceremony is organized or being hosted only when a woman is conceived. And the woman's conception is very important mm-hmm. because woman's conception ensures the legitimacy bond mm-hmm. between man and a woman. And woman during the conception period, the woman's pregnancy has to be within 4 to 5 months. And it is during that period of time that girl's parents can host the marriage party. If woman is not mm-hmm. conceived, then they will not organize any marriage ceremony in the community.
Earlier in your presentation, ma'am, you have also mentioned about sending women for namala, that's for, as a bride. La. If you could explain some more on this. La.
Okay.
It seems that it's not so popular there, la, sending their daughter as a bride.
Yes. Traditionally, Lhop mm-hmm. people believe that their daughter should remain at their ancestral house and they should occupy that house and run the family. And they do not have a practice of sending their daughter away from their home. But however, there are some cases where woman or Lhop daughters become somebody else's nama or daughter-in-law when her lover parents do not have any girl or mm-hmm. daughter, or when the lover is only child in the family. Mm-hmm. So in that cases, the girl's parents will send their daughter to become somebody else's nama, provided that boy's parents have to pay bride price, mm-hmm. which includes 12 nuldrum in the olden days, mm-hmm. 12 nuldrum, 8 silver coins, and 2 live pigs. That means mm-hmm. either piglets or pigs they have to offer as a bride price. And apart from being the bride price, annually boy's parents has to offer 1 earthen pot of fermented millet, that is called bangchang, mm-hmm. to the girl's parents as a gratitude for mm-hmm. letting their daughter stay with her lover at his parents' house. Also, this is the unique thing about their marriage culture.
Ma'am, if you could also talk something about the attaining age of the marriage, for especially for girls.
Girls, in the olden days, Lhop do not have any age limit when it comes to marriage, mm-hmm. because people always prefer early marriages, mm-hmm. for it brings in additional labor and also contribute to financial and domestic support to the family members. So in the olden days, they do not have any age limit because early marriage was considered the most preferred one. But at present, people are aware of the child marriage because Gyok Tsokpa and the Gup always keep people informed about the laws of the countries. Mm-hmm. And people are now aware of the child marriage. Yes. So child marriage is hardly seen now.
Mm-hmm. So ma'am, what about the cross-cousin marriage?
Cross-cousin marriage is the most preferred one because mm-hmm. This brings in strong family bondage. But the Lhop people do not have the system of arranging the cross-cousin marriage. Mm-hmm. In Eastern Bhutan, there is a practice of arranging the cross-cousin marriage mm-hmm. called Serka Khotkin and Matang. Yes. But in case of Lhop community, of course, they can marry with the golden cross-cousin, but mm-hmm. they do not have any system of arranging such marriages mm-hmm. because people believe that marriages has to occur through the consensus between the two lovers. and both parties have to agree when it comes to sex and marriage. Mm-hmm. So parents do not arrange any marriages.
Yes. So what about the monogamy and polygamy?
Monogamy is widely practiced in the community, but polygamy is also being practiced, but very rare at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
But at present, many elderly people, they always prefer monogamy because of the fact that monogamy does not distort the harmony of the family and the community members.
Mm-hmm.
And also monogamy can, when the man marries only with a single wife, then he can put effort in only single household. So they prefer monogamy more than the polygamy.
Ma'am, how long you have been working on this topic, now researching on this particular topic?
I have first started with this topic in the year 2004, but I couldn't continue with the topic because that time I was busy preparing for my RCC examinations. And in the year 2014, I sat for RCC examination and I got through the examination and I did my postgraduate in RM in mm-hmm. the year 2015. So in the year 2016, I was being transferred by RCC to the Land Commission. So in between, I managed to get this information during the coming holidays, mm-hmm. such as Sechu holidays. And in between, I avail casual leave to get the information.
Mm-hmm. While researching on this particular topic, did you encounter with any challenges?
Yes, I faced lots of challenges in writing this article because doing a paperwork is not an easy job and writing paper is also not easy as speaking.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the challenges that I faced during the collection of information is that firstly, we have to make field visit to the Lhop community, and Lhop community is located very far away from the place where I live.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, the collection of information is not easy because we have to depend on the convenience of the community people.
Mm-hmm.
And also we cannot persuade or induce someone to speak. So we have to depend on their convenience. And also one of the challenges that I faced during the collection of the information from the Lhop community is that we hardly understand their language.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we know that there are few Lhops who can speak and understand Dzongkhag, but still there are few elderly Lhops who knows more about their culture, but they find difficulties in expressing because they hardly speak and understand Dzongkhag.
Yes.
Because elderly people are not exposed to modern educations and other facilities, so they hardly understand our questions, and
mm-hmm.
also we hardly understand their expressions. So these are some of the challenges that I faced during the collection of information from the community people.
What were the sources of your research?
Sources, I depend on both primary and secondary. For primary, I have interviewed some elderly Lhops, educated Lhop, non-educated Lhop, and some younger Lhops as well. And at the same time, I have also interviewed some of the immediate neighbors of Lhop, especially those Rais,
mm-hmm.
Nepali-speaking people. And for the secondary resources, I have referred to Dr. Jokadoji's book, and Devin Sharma's book, and other tangible and intangible articles related to marriage custom that are being published by UNESCO and Department of Culture's reference as well.
Asla, ma'am, finally, your message for all listeners, for our youth today and the people of 21st century, how important is our culture, and your message on the importance of preserving and promoting our culture?
Thank you. Firstly, the marriage culture is one of the important components of intangible cultural heritage, and the preservation and promotion of this traditional knowledge is crucial at this stage, because until now, knowledge has been orally transmitted through the generations from one person to another, and it is the responsibility of every Bhutanese to preserve and promote one's own culture. If today's generation fail to preserve one's culture, then it may jeopardize the future of younger generation in identifying their roots for all time to come. And there is also one saying which indicates, "Jisi lam lamse ne pe ring, desi gekhab rawa ten," which means if nation is to stay alive, then we need our cultures to stay alive. And beside this, the preservation and promotion of our culture also ensure security and sovereignty of our country.
Thank you so much for your time, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.
You have been listening to Ngawang Chodun, a researcher who has done a research on unique marriage ceremony of Lhops, a small community in Samtse Dzongkhag. She has presented the research paper during the 8th colloquium on tangible and intangible culture recently in Paro. Hope you had a great time listening, and I'm Tshering Wangmo signing out for now, and thank you for tuning in.